Welcome to the Deerfield Selectboard Board of Health meeting of December 14th, 2016, here in the Deerfield Town Hall in South Deerfield. First item on the agenda that actually isn't on the agenda, we're going to do public comment and bump that up so that, Tom, congratulations. You have
Thank you very much.
Lovely new baby, and so we're very happy for you. So you are representing Cumberland Farms, and so you would like to give us some information. So why don't you introduce yourself and go ahead.
Great. Thank you very much, Madam Chairwoman. Good evening, members of the board. I'm Tom Reedy, an attorney with Bacon Wilson down in Amherst, here on behalf of Cumberland Farms in the public comment period to discuss the proposed project at the corner of Route 5 and Elm Street here in Deerfield. A little bit of background. We are proposing a 4,786 square foot retail convenience store with automobile filling stations. There are going to be four filling stations, meaning eight fueling positions, one on each side. This is to, if we are approved by all of the requisite boards, replace the existing site downtown on Sugarloaf Street, which is about a 2,000 square foot building on a 20,000 square foot lot with two fueling stations, four fueling positions. Mm-hmm. We have been in front of the Conservation Commission. There's a peer reviewer. We've gone back and forth with them. We feel pretty confident that we can satisfy all of the issues that had been raised. We have been in front of the Planning Board, and we have also been in front of the Zoning Board of Appeals. I'm here to get your comments. One of the board, Zoning Board of Appeals, specifically requested comments from you, and I'm sure the Planning Board would like to know as well what issues, if any, you have and how we can address them. Also, as part of our proposal, we are proposing a town sign. So given the location at the corner of Greenfield Road and Elm Street, we thought at the suggestion, the great suggestion of the building commissioner, that we erect a sign that the town could use. Mm-hmm. I've got some examples that I'd like to pass out to you, and these were just concepts that our design team put together, but we can make it whatever it is you want. It's going to be, I think, as we've proposed it, 24 square feet, 8 feet high by 6 feet wide. Obviously, that can change. We're going through the Zoning Board of Appeals process to receive the requisite approval for a directional sign, which is an off-premises sign. So if, Madam Chair, when I could.
Sure.
Hand these to you. These are two separate. You've got five in each, so feel free to hand them out. And those are just schematics to give you a sense of what it is we thought maybe you would like. Obviously not bound by it. And then I will give you a site plan as well.
Oh, thanks.
I will point out where this sign would be located. So on your site plan, mm-hmm. if you're looking, it would be right here.
Okay.
So the state owns a bit of this property, the right-of-way for Greenfield Road. So mm-hmm. the property line only actually starts way back here off I of the see. Road. We're proposing a 25-foot pylon sign, which would have two legs.
Yeah.
And then this one a bit to the, I think that's the east
yes.
of it.
Yeah.
For identification. What we're also proposing, we're talking to the Mass Department of Transportation. We've gotten to a place where we're obviously submitting the applications to the town, because we think that we will be able to get a license from the Massachusetts Department of Transportation. So Greenfield Road in that area is a no-access highway, so we have to go through the Department of Transportation. And what we're proposing off of Greenfield Road is right in and right out. I think you've seen, and if not, I also have some renderings to show you. I don't believe these show where the town sign would be, and there's 5 feet, so you can have you've got two different perspectives and two different angles. Just so you can see what, if approved, it would look like. Yep. Yeah, exactly what Mr. McDaniel has.
Yep, so it would be to the left of that, the large
correct.
Sign.
Yep. Closer in on Elm Street
okay.
For a little bit of context. We will be back before this board. I assume that you are the license granting authority for underground storage tanks. So we will go through that process. Typically, once we have all the approvals from the other boards, then we put together pump and tank plans, get it over to the fire department, make sure that they sign off on it. They are two 20,000-gallon underground storage tanks, interstitial monitoring. So that's 40,000 gallons total. It'll be 32,000 gallons gasoline, 8,000 gallons diesel. The gasoline will be 8,000 gallons premium, and then the balance of it regular, it will be mixed for the mid-grade. But it's state-of-the-art, meets all local, state, and federal regulations. We've also been in discussions with the Department of Environmental Protection. There are some wetlands on the site. It's actually an old roadway ditch, drainage ditch, that we're going to have to cross where you see us getting access from Greenfield Road.
I see the kind of bridge.
Yeah, precisely. Yeah, I think we're doing a box culvert there. Yeah. So I think we're touching the bases, but just to get your comment, any questions that you have, I'm happy to answer them now, take them back to the design team. And we look forward to continuing to be a part of the community here.
I actually believe that we signed off on the comments as no comments.
Fantastic.
Because obviously we're concerned with safety, but that is not, you know, I know you were checking with our police department.
Correct.
I think Sergeant Ruddick.
Correct.
And I know DOT has to give you the curb cut, so we were, you know, there isn't a lot for us to say one way or the other, but safety, of course, is our hugest issue. And I'm really thrilled that you're willing to do a sign for the village, and I actually think Dick's suggestion of having the ability to hang different things underneath, so if there's events or, you know, because a lot of times there's craft shows and, you know, I mean, the churches have craft events, or if the library has a, you know, art auction, or, I mean, just something that we could do, a community kind of thing that could be changeable somehow.
Sure. And so do you like it looks like the wood one is the preferable, and I just want to make sure, because when we go back, we can gussy it up a bit.
I like it. Yeah, I like it too.
I mean, I was just going to say it sort of goes with, it's not like we have architecture, but but it just somehow that we have the ability to update events, and maybe if we have some businesses or something that we could put in there, I don't know. I mean, obviously you don't want to cause it to be so busy that nobody sees
it.
Right,
it's a fine balance. I like the idea of old home day sign can hang.
Yeah,
bottom,
I mean, we've always had stuff out front that, you know, stuff that's going on, like old home day kind of thing. And so events, community events would seem like a good thing, and maybe we could just figure out a couple advertisements of businesses, local businesses or whatever. I don't know. I mean, like I said, I don't want to complicate it and make it too busy, but it would be wonderful to have further discussion and get people's input and have ideas come together, and we could do something that's a little bit nicer for the village.
That'd be so great. We're open to it. And if the size, if you want any change to the size, let us know. I mean, we're...
It's good like it is.
I think it fits in with the rest of, if you've seen those Cumberland Farm stores, I mean, they're well-maintained, well-manicured. You've got the landscaping there, the green grass.
Yep.
They're clean, nice, New England-esque type of stores with the dormers on them. So,
that's what certainly looks like it.
Yep. Yeah, no, we think it'll be a really good addition. And you've got an older site, kind of a condensed site, so I think, and
that's
we're also exploring.
You can get in there and get gas. Yeah,
exactly. So it's just tight.
It is very tight.
Could I add something?
Yeah.
About this board not having any comments on that request, I did watch the zoning board meeting, and I'm not sure how to take it. When they read that we had no comment, they said, well, we wish that we would have made a comment one way or the other. It's usually been my understanding if we make no comment and we have no opposition. So I'd like to take this opportunity to speak for myself as a member of this board that I think it's a good project. I think it will be good for the town.
Yeah.
I think it fits really good. It looks good. Besides the benefit of taxes, the tax revenue, I think it's going to be a good service for all of the, you know, members of our community. So with that being said...
I would second that, too. I wanted to thank you for investing in our town. You know, this store is, as you have mentioned, you know, it's been here a long time, and it is tight, and it's served its purpose. It's run out of its lifespan. So an investment like this in our town, very grateful for. So.
I agree, and I guess I, when I said no comment, I meant it as more positive. So
yeah.
Thank
right.
you for
well,
bringing
right.
it up.
I think that's what we were thinking.
But I was just wondering on your old site, there was some discussion about putting a restriction on another convenience store. Is that really necessary, you think?
Yeah,
think so,
so typically standard practice is any time that they're looking to divest themselves from a site or lease it if they can't sell it, because they don't want, as much as the town doesn't want, an empty building just
right,
sitting
right.
there. So really to just prevent competition, it's their standard practice to either deed restrict it, if that's what they're doing is conveying it, or restrict it in the lease to no convenience stores, no automobile filling stations. And as I mentioned,
okay.
you know, no food service. I mean, there is a fine line, but those are just the kind of blanket ones. The reality is that once they convey it, they don't have control over it anymore. So while we might think that, okay, a convenience store on that site might not do it anything, it may in the future start to dig into their business if that convenience store all of a sudden acquires an adjacent parcel and now we've got another larger store
right.
in that site. We've lost our ability to control anything.
Mm-hmm.
So that's... standard practice.
Into that fact, Carolyn, it's there has been an empty or vacant store in that downtown area for I think 3 years now or more, and if someone was willing or had wanted to put a convenience store in there, there's been opportunity and there's been no action on that. So I don't really know that a deed restriction is going to be all that bad for the community.
Yeah.
And it is a tough thing because as landowners, they do have the right to do that type of thing, so.
Mm-hmm.
Just my gut feeling is, I know you're gonna pull the tanks yeah. and clean that up. I'd even love to see the building gone, just because it's old and tired.
Sure.
And, you know, that's kind of, that my personal thing would be great if that was just a vacant lot so people could start to do whatever they wanted. Either the town could purchase it for whatever reason or people could come in and put in a nice Italian restaurant or something like that there.
Absolutely.
You know, that, I don't know how much more life you get out of that building anyways. It's been there my whole life, I think, or pretty close to.
It's been there a little while. I'm not going to age you, but it's
yeah.
been there a little while. And I think it really just comes down to the market. And
yeah.
if a butter says, yes, we want it, and we want it for parking, or yes, we want it,
right.
and we're going to do something to combine the buildings.
Yeah.
I think that's we're going to let the market dictate that
Understood.
To some extent.
Yep.
If the butter doesn't show interest, I think... we would be happy to have a discussion with the
mm-hmm.
town, whether we give some sort of option for the
right.
town to purchase it, some exclusivity of negotiation for a certain period of time. I think that's something we would be willing to do as well.
Just
okay.
so you know that it was built in 76, because in 75, Cumberland Farms was in Jerry's place.
Is that right?
Okay.
So almost my whole life.
Here we are.
All right.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah,
I really appreciate it.
I appreciate it as well.
And well, sure. Sarah was very accommodating. And
yeah. Thank you very much.
So
enjoy that baby.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you very much. I'll try
thank
to get
you.
Some sleep.
Yes.
Have fun.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sarah, why don't you come on up? And I appreciate you waiting so that Tom could just have a couple minutes with us.
I'm going to put all these together and leave them in town hall.
Yeah.
So I don't need
them.
Okay.
I'll put them on the other stairs. How are you?
I'm fine.
Good. Good to see you.
Thanks for having us.
Sure.
Sarah Woodbury, Library Director, and Nancy Maynard, our trusty chair, and chair of the Hilton Fund.
Thank you for coming in and giving us an update.
Well, we don't really have a prepared a presentation for you tonight. What
sure.
I thought, it might just be interesting to find out a little bit about what's going on at the library. And one of the things I thought of that some people might not realize is that when the snow flies, we close the front entrance up the steps. Mm-hmm. We went through a lot to decide to do this. It's because the treatment that's used for ice on marble doesn't treat the marble very well. And when marble is icy, it's very, very slippery. There are some strips that you might know what they are, but there's a special name for them. They're inside the marble. But the trustees decided on my recommendation, because I had done the research, that we really shouldn't have it open when it's snowy. So we close them in the winter and then look forward to opening them again in the spring. So that's the what came to mind. We are having a and we're excited about this program that's part of the 100th anniversary celebration. It's an antiques appraisal by Douglas
cool.
Auctioneer. It's free.
Cool.
If you have anything that you want, you can bring up to two items. You have to sign up at the library.
Oh, great.
It's a really nice thing that he's doing for us.
Is that on the webpage?
It's January 11th. It is on the website.
Okay.
It starts at 5, and you can sign up. You sign up for for a slot at 5, 5:15, 5:30, and until 8:15.
Great.
So we think that's going to be a lot of fun, just to bring your item and also to watch.
Especially in this area with all the things in people's...
Like an antique roadshow, but local.
I know my mom is going to love to go to that. Yeah, there's all kinds of little things people have.
How fun is that?
That's
really great.
Posted all over town to remind people about that.
Great idea.
And there'll be a snow date, January 18th. So some other programs. Julie's doing a Lego program. It's called a Lego Challenge. It's all done kind of either you can build something at home or you can do it at Tilton. Take a picture of it, and then kids will be voting online for the best. And there'll be just winners will be announced. And
there's lots of books at the library about building with Legos to give you ideas.
Yeah,
right.
Yep.
Recently been purchased.
Yep. And she's starting something called Escape the Library, designed on something called Escape Rooms, which they're puzzles that you get into a place and you try to get out by... have you heard of
them? I've heard of this. Yeah. I think the Eastworks building has one in East Hampton. Yeah. I think you go in and you've got to do all these puzzles to get back out.
Well, ours will be a little different because we don't really have the room.
Sure, sure.
Based on that. Then we have a parent discussion group that's meeting Monday, January 23rd, and as usual, we have preschool story time on Wednesdays. And we also have our book discussion groups that are ongoing. do you have any questions for us?
No, it sounds like you're having all these great activities and that your fundraising activities are really kicking in, and I think that's wonderful.
So the real big focus for Sarah during the month of January is she will be working on the building application to go to the Mass Board of Library Commissioners. So, you know, we have a lot of focus of gathering all the documents that we need to have for that. We have finished meeting with the town committees that we felt were really integral to that, to educate them. So we met with the Capital Improvement Committee last week, and we met with the Finance Committee a month ago. And our next step is to start working with different community organizations so that, we do education within the schools and the senior center so that we continue to keep that awareness going and get feedback about the process, questions that are surfacing.
So are we competing against Greenfield and Orange? Because there was two articles in the newspaper about...
Greenfield and Orange will most
be in this...
They will be applying, as far as I know, for a construction grant. There's about 31 libraries. Amherst, Hadley.
So there's a lot of Western Mass ones.
Yes,
this time.
There are. Previously, it was a lot of Eastern Massachusetts libraries, and this year there is there's more...
Western Mass.
One in Monterey. Yes.
Okay. So we'll know, everyone will know sometime in July.
There's an exact date, July.
Okay. All right. All right.
I wanted to thank you for, you and Julie, for all you're doing there. My son, we can't always get home, so he's been walking over after school and with some of the other kids from the elementary school and reading and playing games and doing stuff there until we can get them. Mm-hmm. So it's been just very invaluable to us to have that safe place for your child to go for an hour or so until you can get home. Yep. And really good.
And it's I think it's great because it's within walking distance.
Yes.
So much. So many towns, that's not
true. Yeah. Yep, we're very lucky.
Ideal location is ideal village.
Yep. It's been great.
We'd like to keep it that way. We have these little frequently asked questions.
So as the capital campaign has been moving forward, we've been developing a lot of materials, and from all the meetings going back to the special town meeting, we've been collecting the questions that have surfaced for people. And so we've been working to have those written up as documents that we can give out, put those on our website, give those when we start doing our capital campaign work, because people need to be able to refer to that, and we need to be ensuring that we have correct, accurate information out there in the community. So we have a copy of the hot off the press version. Certainly we'll be adding to those questions, because you know there's always going to be questions, or as things get clarified as we move along. So we have a copy of that for you.
Oh, that would be lovely.
Wonderful. Yeah. That's a great idea.
They'll be on our website, or are on the website. We're working to do that. But
oh, that's good.
You know, we really, you know, felt that we wanted to make sure that, you know, there was a great place for that, and it's helpful for the board. We want consistent answers, you know, that are going out to the public.
I think one of the questions that came up in the Capital Improvement Committee is you know, operational costs. Mm-hmm. And I think if we can get answers to that, that would be very helpful, because mm-hmm. that was, it makes sense that that would come up.
Yes, and so the board sort of has a tickler list of things that we need to focus conversations on, and that will be something for the spring discussion.
So having operational discussion of what the impact on operational costs would be a huge thing to talk about. And I don't know, there was different ones that had come up. I know your glass, you know, the front being all glass, that actually
that atrium connection.
Yeah, mm-hmm. the atrium connection, that was a really good question of yours, Kip, and that got answered.
That's certainly
But if we think of anything else, we'll be sure to let you guys know.
And that's been one of the messages as we go, using the chair people to be the conduit to the library, you know, if questions surface in their committees, so that, you know, they're getting accurate information to share with their committees as well.
Yeah, I think that's very helpful.
And what has happened in those committee meetings is they've been great dialogues about, you know, thoughts and how, you know, everybody has a different vantage point that they come to about whatever the question is. And so for us to understand that has been really helpful, but they've been really, you know, good, healthy dialogues, which is really important for us to see. And people, you know, are really feeling committed to the project that way when they feel like there's a good dialogue going back and forth.
Well, and all their questions have been answered, I mean, completely. And that's, I think that's very helpful. So... Was there anything you
wanted? Well, the only thing I want to do is I guess it's a little bit of a, I think of as an educational statement, is that, you know, we just finished our school roof, and I was very much opposed of the way we went about it. Not that the roof didn't need to be replaced, just the process. I brought these books out for you girls to see. This is half of the closeout documents for the school roof. Mm-hmm. The 5,000 residents of Deerfield had to pony up nearly $200,000 for this type of stuff. And this is what scares me about the library. Mm-hmm. I see the numbers, and, you know, it isn't the library that's going to cost. It's this type of stuff. And I don't really have an answer. But, you know, if you ask questions, which I intend to do, I hope to eliminate this type of waste, you know.
So this is what you're referring to, is this, these huge...
All these books. Yes. That's half of them. Those are just...
That had to be produced
that
in order
were, for... Well, they didn't have to be. We're talking about shingling a roof and stuff. But if you look deep enough in there, they will have specifications for every nail, every screw, every glue, anything that ever went on there. You know, there's site assessments. Mm. They talked about... contractors eating lunch on the grass, you know, this is the type of things that some of these engineering firms and architectural firms do. And it's just a shame, because people around here work so hard for their money, and to spend it on stuff like this is just you know, just think about what you could do now if somebody just gave the library $200,000. And here it is, you know.
You could build something out of that, it looks like.
Mm-hmm. Well, you could, on a Friday night, you could start a campfire and right, roast marshmallows. But, you know, and this is a big opposition of mine, you know. Yes. It's just such a wasteful thing. But this is what happens when you get into these big bureaucratic domains, you know. And I, you know, it seems late, or it is late for me to get involved with your project. Mm-hmm. But I tried hard to avoid this with the roof, and I was not successful. So I don't know if there's anything you folks can do through discussions going forward. But, you know, if you can avoid this, it would be greatly appreciated.
I'm with you there.
And I think we all.
I know you look at it and it's like, wow.
Yes, and I think we do what we can do, yeah. But I think sometimes, I mean, I don't know, that's scary to me. But
and it is, it's half of them, you know. I just didn't want to carry them all over. I'm afraid they're going to slide over. Mm-hmm. And I think for shingling the roof, you got to be kidding me, you know.
Well, I think that's why it's really valuable, actually, Kip, that you do get involved, because, you know, we were able to get the roof done. We have a better roof, better shingles, and it was under budget and on time. And it was a lot to do with you and Dick.
But it almost seems, you know, from where I sit, if I try to get involved with their project, all I'm going to do is derail it.
No, I don't think that's true. No, we're looking forward to you know, meeting with you.
Because what now will happen is the Planning and Design Committee will, you know, be terminated at some point as we get forward to the, you know, the application process, the building process. And then we will be forming a new committee with important people that have knowledge about construction and building and different components that, you know, will work closely with the OPM and the architect as we go forward. And so that is one of the next jobs of the board, is to think about what the composition of that committee can be. And we're, you know, looking at variety. We have wonderful resources in this town of builders that have done great projects. So we know we have the resources to be able to do that. And so that will be something that we'll be looking forward. And, you know, Mark Gilmore was part of the Planning and Design Committee. You know, it was very helpful to have a selectman representative on that committee. Mm-hmm. So we hope that.
And I think, I mean, I'm not, I know I keep giving you jobs to
no,
do.
No, it is. But, I don't. No, Carolyn, I don't mind the job at all. It's
just. I think you will have good influence.
As I listen to you speak, you know, I'm just sitting here, and because this is what OPMs and architects do.
This is how
they justify their money. You know,
is we don't by, have a choice but to have an OPM.
Well, but see, the thing is, that's exactly what the school department said. And I stood up in this room and I said, no, you don't want to go down that alley. You get the state involved, you get people from Boston out there that you don't know, and they're going to justify everything. They're smart people, they're cunning people, and they're going to justify everything that's in these books. I'd be willing to bet the people that built the original library didn't have an OPM and an architect. You know, mm-hmm. They had good craftspeople. Mm-hmm. And that, mm-hmm. You know, you can build you can build an addition on the library, and you don't have to go that road, but it's a path that you've gone down.
Actually,
and that's what I'm saying. I don't think that I can, you know, I don't mind, and I would do anything that I can to help you, but I think the big part of the...
We are constrained by public procurement laws, and so it would be wonderful.
I think what Kip is saying is right, that it's one of these things where you'd have to get involved, you know, years earlier to change legislation to not allow the OPM and the architect, obviously you want, but sometimes there's so much written in and lobbied in from these organizations
really
in Boston
to
get job security. I mean, it's really what that is. I mean, they're doing it for a reason, because sometimes people build and they're not safe. And then it collapses on children. So there's a reason why all that happens, but it's a fortune. You're spending so much money on it where you could do it.
My understanding is that the the town can do the OPM job. Maybe I'm thinking of Clerk of the Works, but wasn't the Sean, the former highway person, he served as the OPM for the garage?
You still have to have an assigned OPM.
Yes, But we could use someone internally if we needed.
Was there a dollar amount tied to that?
No. You mean to trigger it?
Yes.
Yes, there is a trigger point. I'm not sure exactly.
Under that new municipal modernization, did they raise that limit?
Yes, they did, but I don't.
You know, I mean, and in that, like, what happened with the school roof is we could have created the documents ourselves, and we could have put it out to bid and had the same contractor do the same work. If he had to do that, we could have had that roof for $800,000 instead of $1,569,000. We wouldn't have had all of this. You know, it took him almost 3 months, as long as it did to do the whole job, just to compile all of this paperwork. Drove the poor guy crazy, you know. And
so are we going to, we'll get to that, but what I was wondering is the state pays for half. And
do you think we would save half by not doing it? Question. Can we do it for under half?
Yeah.
Well, that's what I'm saying. About now, we're at that break point where, you know, it's 800,000, it's half of that. So it would have cost us the same, you know, at that point. But in the meantime, you know, we started out a lot higher.
Oh, yes.
But that was
because you saved us money.
Well, it took a lot of tense meetings to get, you know, people to come down. I mean, these architects were just brutal. I mean, they wouldn't even let us pick the color of the shingle because they were the designer. I mean, their egos were bigger than this room. And, you know, you meet these people and they're really nice, but when you start dealing with them, it's like, you know, they hold you hostage all the way around. And they wanted to come for more meetings, and then they say, well, we only allotted so much time. You either sign this thing saying we're going to, what was it, $25,000. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we're going to stop doing paperwork. You know, they stop doing paperwork, we don't get the reimbursement. So it was awful.
It was. And
these people that are coming in and telling you how, you know, oh, we're doing this for you, trust me. They're looking out for themselves. And every inch of the way, they're going to stick it to the town any way they can, whether it's, you know, material that has to be done or construction contingencies or Lord knows everything else, you know. And it's scary, you know. And in a lot of communities, the folks don't know, and so they just pay. And, you know, they figure, well, if whether the project's $5 million or $10 million, this is what we have to pay to get this, you know. And that's the sad part about it.
But Kip, I think you would be good, because you could help make that judgment whether can we get this built for, you know, I mean, can we get a good product on time, and at a reasonable expense? Because you would be able to tell that.
I would be willing to help. I don't know if that process has already gone too far. That if for some reason that the town is turned down in the first round. I don't know the timetable, but maybe that would be a good opportunity to start. I don't want to say start all over, but start like a parallel, you know, comparison. Say, look at this is, you know, this is what you wanted. This is how we can go about achieving it, and, you know, this is what it would cost.
But I think the application, you haven't even put the application together yet.
It goes in the end of January.
Yeah.
But the whole application is just to get state money.
Right, but we still have to approve that, and so.
But if the town was going to build it on their own, they don't have to get approval from anybody.
But that would be a way that you could compare.
Oh, exactly. Sure. That's what I'm saying.
This is going through this process versus this process.
Just because we do the application doesn't mean we accept it in the end either, or the town doesn't vote it.
What type of obligation has been made to the architect, though, going forward, though?
None.
None?
We could be done with these people.
You got the grant to do the original thing.
Yeah, they had a grant.
But also, I mean, I will say, and I know that you know this, that the grant does provide to 50% of the construction cost. So it is an opportunity for people, taxpayers, to get some of the money that they've been paying back and getting back to the town. So, but I know you know that.
And also, I don't, when you talk about grants now, is that the 50% reimbursement type grant? Is that what you're talking about, or is it in addition to that?
I don't know. I'm not sure what that means.
Well, in other words, I don't know for sure, but isn't the Library Association, would they reimburse the town up to 50% or somewhere around that area of the cost of the building?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's.
So if you speak of a grant, is that a grant for the town that would not, you know, encumber this money from the Library Association? In other words, if our share.
The state would not will not grant the Tilton Fund the grant. The grant will go to the town of Deerfield. The town of Deerfield is the grant recipient.
Okay. So if regardless of the dollar amount, whether it was $100,000 or $1 million, the town would get that regardless of the money they got from the Library Association.
Correct.
More discussions to come.
Yeah.
So, on that note, you want to give them these? No. I thought I'd give you these.
But we are also having raffling an anniversary quilt. And here's we thought you might accept a ticket packet.
Oh, thank you.
For your holiday gift giving. You can give everybody in your family a ticket.
Okay. So it'll be wrapped off in October 2017.
Oh,
it was made by six residents of the town.
That's nice.
All scrap fabric, sort of circa 1916 pattern that we used. The quilt is on display in the library. We'll be at very variety of venues throughout the year.
Nice.
We've entered it in the Quilts Across the Valley April show at UMass.
I think I have a shirt that was made like that.
So,
this is really nice. This is wonderful.
That's a great idea.
I think
if you want to look at it.
Okay.
But I think it's so nice that you're making such an effort to raise money and get the library out in the community.
Mm-hmm. We're really excited about this opportunity.
Yeah.
It was timely for us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
100 years old, and when the women who made this quilt, they did it really quickly and worked.
Yeah, we started in June, and it was finished in September when a quilter did the actual final quilting of it together.
Oh, these are the questions. Great. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you.
The questions.
Document in progress.
The next time you see it, it might look different. It might be much longer.
It'll grow.
So I think there might be a date on the end of that one, but we'll have more documents.
Okay. No, this is fantastic.
Wonderful.
Oh yes, you do.
Yep.
On the back page.
Yes.
That's a good idea, so that you can
especially
update
that
it.
Document. We know that it will evolve as questions surface.
Right.
More information is deciphered to and put in that. But many of our other documents will probably not change.
Okay.
So we have a community statement and those kinds of things that we're working on.
Well, that's wonderful.
This is great.
And,
great information.
I really appreciate it. And hopefully we can get Kip on board with you on the project so he can. I mean, really,
we'll keep that in
mind
as we start to form the committee in the spring.
Well, I mean, I went to a ton of meetings all summer with him, and, you know, we got the triple laminate shingles versus the single laminate, but they're really a lot safer because it was, you know, we were within because of the way the mounting system was or the, you know, design, the, Kip and Dick.
The snow load capacity. We had reached the top of the snow load capacity.
We were within an ounce and a half of the capacity code. And so every time we had a snowstorm, we'd be freaking out that the weight load would be terrible. And then, you know, there was design issues with the roof, and Dick and Kip were able to straighten that out. And, I mean, they're just And it turned out it was cheaper, and it was on time. There was no delay of school start, which was really at the beginning of summer.
For all that, I mean,
it was really a problem.
And every Wednesday we had a, what did they call those meetings? Progression. I don't know, but every Wednesday we met.
Update
we met for
meetings.
3 hours. And it cost the town $8,000 every Wednesday to have these meetings. And we spoke of
it.
We're shingling a roof here. We're shingling a roof here. But yet they would talk about every other thing. Did you get this? Oh, yeah. Did you get that? I sent you an email. Okay. It's just back and forth. And it was like so redundant week after week.
But it was really Kip and Dick that actually went up on the roof to make sure that stuff was done.
But we did have a great contractor, too. I mean, you know, the people, the design engineers made such a big deal about things on paper, you know, and to the layperson, it would make you seem like it was going to cave in. And we'd go up there and look, and it was no big deal. It was nothing, you know, it really was nothing. And yet the next week there'd be another disaster,
And they wanted nails that weren't even available.
No, the screws. Yeah, they wanted screws and metal. And they said, we used them before. Fine, where do we get them? I mean, you produce all this paperwork. Tell us where to get these screws. They couldn't do it, you know. It was like, you know, just one thing after another.
It was going to delay the roof. Why they searched for these screws that didn't exist.
Yeah,
and the blackmailing kind of stuff was terrible. Yeah. But anyway, I
well, hopefully we all can learn from that experience. And
well, that's what I mean. I think, I mean, I'm not really trying you to, but I think you have bring valuable knowledge to the table that really helps the, you know, have an end product that really would be beneficial to the town versus, and also in a timely manner. I mean, that's really important too. Not to drag it out and stuff. So okay. I don't know. Anyway,
thank you.
Really appreciate the updates, and I'm sure that we will have more questions. And I'm hoping that Kip will look through this, and if he has any other questions, he can contact you.
You know how to get in touch with us.
Yes. Yep. And we'll try to circulate this. I know you said it was on the website, but...
Well, it hasn't gone on the website yet. We just finished. We're going to add another question. So it will be up. It will be
being
up
on the website would be great.
So that's a great way to refer it for people.
Yeah, and then we'll try to get...
because that's where the most current copy will be.
Yes, keep it updated there.
And try to get people to participate. So... Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks.
Happy holidays.
Stay warm.
Merry Christmas.
Yes,
stay warm. Next on the agenda, Bill, I hope you don't mind. We're running a little bit late. I'd like to spend a few minutes on our tobacco hearing. We are actually running the tobacco hearing again so that it was correctly posted in the newspapers and in the out in the lobby and on our website, everything. Nothing has changed. This is the exact same verbiage that we had before. I just want to run over the highlights so that when we actually go to vote, this will be part of the minutes. Oh, yes. Go ahead. So, please read that.
Deerfield Board of Health hearing notice. A public hearing will be held by the Deerfield Board of Health at the Deerfield Town Hall, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass., on December 14, 2016, at 6:45 p.m. to consider adopting tobacco regulations entitled Regulations Restricting the Sale of Tobacco Products. The regulation includes new policies to restrict the sale of tobacco products and nicotine delivery products, including cigar packaging and capping the number of tobacco permits. It includes restrictions on the sale of flavored tobacco products, increases the minimum legal age, sales age to 21, and bans the sale of tobacco products within 500 feet of a school, regulates coupons and e-cigarette flavor containers. The penalty section includes the possible revocation of a tobacco sales permit after multiple offenses. The regulation is available for inspection during business hours at the town hall in the town clerk's office.
Okay, thank you, Trevor.
Sure.
As Trevor just read, there are a couple things that we want to point out. We are defining blunt wrap, characterizing a flavor, especially this is like candy, cocoa, dessert, alcoholic beverage, herb, spice, anything like that that would attract kids, especially, is one thing that we're making sure that we're covering. We are increasing the minimum age to 21. I think that is very important. This is according to general laws, Mass General Laws, Chapter 270, Section 7. This will be need to be posted now at our permit holders. I believe there's five. Mm-hmm. That it is now 21 years of age. We are reducing the number of tobacco permits. We had originally capped it at 10. We are now lowering it to 8. We have 5 active permits at this point. If, as of January 1st, 2017, somebody else drops out, then we will reduce the cap further as that, you know, as each permit holder drops out. But we've capped it at 8 effective January 1st. And again, there's only 5 active permit holders in town, so this is not really a problem. Again, the sale of flavored tobacco products, which are defined in the beginning of the regulation, will be prohibited, especially the candy-flavored ones is what we're targeting. Displays, we have some regulation on displays. And of note here is now we have formally spelled out our violations, and I just want to clarify what we have proposed is for the first violation is a $100 fine. In the case of a second violation, within 24 months of the date of the first violation, a fine of $200, and the tobacco product sales permit may be suspended for 7 consecutive business days. So we are not using the word shall, we're saying may. So we may, as depending on the circumstances. In the third case, however, in 24-month period of either one of those violations, $300 fine, and the tobacco product sales permit shall be suspended for 30 consecutive days. So it's one thing if it's a one-off, and we might consider it if some other circumstances on the second one. But by the third time, that's it. So we wanted to point that out. And the regulation will be enforced by the Deerfield Board of Health or our designated agents. So in other words, if there's a sting operation by the tobacco coalition that we are a member of, or our school resource officer wants to do something, then they will be allowed to do that. And these regulations will take effect on January 1st, 2017. Is there any comments from anyone, or did you all want to talk about this at all?
No.
Okay.
I'm good.
Okay. Then I will close the public comment, public hearing part, and we will vote. I propose that we close the hearing.
Second.
Is there any further discussion on that?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Do you all have anything do you want to say further?
Nope.
No,
I just think it's good. You know, it just helps protect the young people in the community. And I know that a lot of times young people don't always take advice from their elders, but, you know, I've seen so many times you just don't know how bad this really is for you. And it's one of those things that just sneaks up on you, and afterwards it's just too late.
Yeah.
Well, these e-cigarettes and marketing to the kids really bothers me.
Yeah, it does.
And all the other towns around us have Sunderland, Waitley, Montague, Greenfield, everybody is 21, so we certainly don't want to attract other surrounding towns' children into our town. So I think we're protecting our town and our own children, and as well as surrounding neighbors. Mm-hmm. So if there's no further discussion, then I will take a motion to approve these regulations as presented.
I make a motion to approve the regulations restricting the sale of tobacco products as depicted.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So it's unanimous. All right. Done. Thank you. I'm sorry that it took us a while to get through this, but it was properly posted now.
Do you have a question?
Yeah.
Come.
Oh, sure.
Is it the Board of Health or the Select Board? Is that two votes?
Oh, we are the Board of Health.
Okay.
We voted as the Board of Health. When Trevor read the public hearing, we were acting as the Board of Health. And but it's a Select Board, we support it as well. Okay. Next item on the agenda, we'll bounce down to the annual licenses because Bill is here to make a comment. So we'll skip down to that. We have a proposed list of license renewals. Bill, why don't you come up, and you had a comment on one of the renewals.
Sure. It's Bill Swayze, Chief of the South Deerfield Fire Department. Our district has six applicants that are in the renewal process. We went and we inspected the six. Two passed the first go-around, no issues at all. Two others had some minor issues. We re-inspected those. The fifth one, we are back there this morning. They're substantially complete. We're fine with that. The sixth one is Afterworks Bar. That property always seems to be a chore every year of getting them in compliance. They have not done their annual fire alarm inspection, which is required. We actually reached out to the vendor on his behalf to try to see if he had scheduled it and have them reach out to him. They had done that a couple weeks ago. They didn't get a response from him. So my recommendation to the board and to Dick Kalaszewski was not to proceed with, I'm not going to sign off on it. So that got back to the building owner, Mike McGrath. I got a call from him this afternoon. I explained my position as to why I wasn't going to sign off on his renewal application for the life safety inspection. He reached out to the alarm vendor. They're scheduled to do the inspection on Friday. He asked if I would still sign off on that contingent, and I stated I wouldn't because, you know, in the past we've had issues with that property. If there's any deficiencies that they find during that alarm thing, you know, it's life safety, and that's what I explained to him. And I don't know the process. Usually by this time, all six are compliant, and I've never come before you in the 5 years that I've been doing the inspections, but my hope is by Friday afternoon I receive an inspection report in that there's no deficiencies, and then I'd be fine signing off on it. So we also have the fire extinguisher needs to be inspected by a licensed contractor, so that's another deficiency. So,
well, we have another meeting that we could officially approve the Afterworks liquor license renewal effect. I think it's the 28th. So if we get your sign off, we could vote that on the 28th. So
okay.
What
so
I would
that.
Recommend us to do then would be to vote renewal of the list, except have a hold on Afterworks
until we get
your clearance.
Approval.
Yep. And I very much appreciate you coming in and letting us
know
about
that. It's all about life safety, and that's what I explained to the owner of the building. And I feel bad for the business owner because, you know, it's not his responsibility. It's not his property.
Right.
He pays rent, and it's the building owner that, you know, is holding him up of doing his business.
Right.
So.
Well, you look at what happened out in Oakland.
you know, lost 30 people or more out there.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it all comes from the Station nightclub fire back in 2003, and the state of Massachusetts developed this program where the building officials in the fire department, you know, work together and inspect it. And, you know, like I said, for the 5 years I've been doing it, you know, it's been fairly seamless. You know, it's just this one that seems year after year we've got to work at it a little bit more than the others.
Yeah.
And this year they didn't get it done.
Okay.
And I don't feel comfortable signing off on it.
So was it the business owner's responsibility, or are you saying it's the landlord?
It's the landlord. It's the building owner. So.
Yeah. Well, we will make a note on this. We'll hold off on the renewal.
Yep.
And unfortunately for the afterworks, you know, they are being penalized, but.
Well, as long as it gets done, it won't interrupt it, because don't these expire at the end of the year?
Yes.
So it would be renewed before that.
I
would think that the building owner would be happy to, you know, get it done, because otherwise he's going to lose a tenant.
Exactly, and that's what he's working at, and, you know, and he got them in there this Friday morning, first thing, you know, and, you know, and he's, you know, I said it's fine, you know, I need to have that inspection report, and there can't be any deficiencies, or else we're going to have to wait for those deficiencies to get repaired.
Right. Right.
So.
Yep. I know.
Okay. Right. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time.
Really appreciate it.
I really appreciate you taking the time to come in. Sorry to make you wait.
Oh, that's fine.
So
everything else was okay here?
Yeah. I just want to make sure that we're clear that the building owner is not in compliance.
Correct.
Not signed off. What I'll do is I'll put a sticky on this too. I mean, it's here in the notes, but I will put a sticky so Pat knows that, and I will follow up with a phone call tomorrow morning.
And we're waiting on these three here to finish up. Renewal's not received to date.
Yeah, we would not vote on those last three
applications and stuff yet.
Right.
Okay.
So it would just be this list.
Okay.
I just have a question.
Sure.
I'm just curious on the entertainment thing. Why would one company need to have four different entertainment licenses if they all do the same thing? You know, it's all in one place. Like there's one for, you know, artists, theater, painting, music.
It's different. If it's different licensing and it goes to different. Like the face paint thing is a different department of the state, because
Department of Public Health?
Because you're putting stuff on people's faces.
I see. Okay.
Dinner theater is I don't know the art, which group handles the art stuff, but live music is different than dinner theater,
mm-hmm.
which is different than, you know, your artists that come in and do that. You know, memes and stuff like that. So, I know. We're not just charging Kip, honest. Paperwork goes to different people
state. I just wanted to learn.
This is why Pat has been so crazed, because she just wants to make sure she has all the paperwork to the right agency.
We have quite a small town. There's not really all that many.
It's true, but there's enough. And you don't want to mess up the
Can you imagine what they are in Northampton?
Oh, mm. Wicked.
Or Springfield.
Yeah, there's a lot of restaurants and stuff like that. So, anyway.
I make a motion to accept the FY 2017 license renewals as listed, except on hold would be Afterworks LLC for the building until Fire Chief Swayze gives us the all clear. We can approve that December 28th.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. Is there any further discussion?
No.
Let me just write down that we're approving the list. I think that's with the hold. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Okay.
One other thing. I noticed at the bottom that there were three non-renewals yet. Is that something that if it comes between now and our next meeting, we approve it then? Or what happens if they're not, if they don't come in by the end of the year?
We would want to get this done?
I don't know.
I'm just going to reach out to them and see what's going on.
Yeah, Pat has reached out.
Okay.
And they haven't, for whatever reason, they haven't come in.
Okay.
So.
Okay. All right.
And we have, you know, this came up.
Yep.
So, I mean, maybe that's one of the reasons. I don't know.
Hmm.
Anyway, we're all set on that.
Okay.
So going back, I just want to reiterate, we did talk about it last week, and maybe, Andy, you can put in the newspaper that our January 9th town meeting was canceled. We're postponing it. There's still some items on there, but the main item that was driving the meeting was the ability for the select board to set the permits. And Bruce St. Peter's had gone in and done research in the vault and came up with in 2004 annual town meeting, spring annual town meeting, we approved this town meeting approved the authority of the select board to set fees. So that has been all, you know, was driving that, and so that is saving us a meeting and an evening out. And again, thanks to Bruce St. Peter's for that, especially if it's a cold night. I just want to announce that I did get a National Weather Service alert that is forecasting a huge Arctic front coming in, and it's going to be bitterly cold. The wind chills are going to be 15 to 25 below zero tomorrow night into Friday morning, with wind gusts to 40 to 50 miles an hour. It's supposed to be really brutally cold. So I just want to remind people to take care of their animals and make sure that their pets are protected, and that they take extra care, turn up the heat to keep from getting frozen pipes. If we do lose any electricity due to downed trees because of the wind gusts, we will open up the town hall here. We do have an emergency generator that will heat this side of the town hall. It's not 100%. We have some electricity for lights on this side, but not a lot. The police have no heat, but they have plenty of lights. So between the two, we will have a place where people can come get warm. If you can't get out of your house, John Pachorik, our Chief Pachorik, has been working on some ideas on to get pick up to get people here. So if there are problems, we'll be able to deal with it. But people need to take as many precautions as necessary and be safe. It's a half an hour outside, and you're going to have frostbite. So this is terrible.
Talking of, winds 15 to 20, but gusts to 65 tomorrow night into the 4 a.m.
Record cold weather. How can this be? We're suffering from global warming.
It's because of global warming. It's
freezing cold. It's going to be freezing cold because of global warming. I get
snowball.
It's a polar vortex. It opened up.
Somehow it's caused by global warming.
I know. But it's one of those freaky things that... And we just have weather events now.
We can't push this too hard because my wife will want to bring her horse in the house, and I can't deal with that.
I know, but we've got to put blankets on and...
He has more blankets than I do.
I know. My horse does, too. I got to go put them on tonight on the way home. Anyway, also, there are no more scheduled flu clinics, but there are flu shots available from our town nurse, Lisa White, on Wednesdays, 10 to 2 at the town hall. Just bring your insurance card and Medicaid or Medicare card with you and fill out the paperwork. It takes 2 seconds. And she does a wonderful job. I just got my flu shot today, and it's so nice to go in there, and there's a lot less bugs and germs than at a doctor's office.
You hardly notice those spots at all, Karen.
Oh man, I'm telling you, it's really nice to have our town nurse do it. So, she's wonderful. So please come in and get your flu shot. Outreach coordinator.
Yes.
We need to vote that. Trevor, can you give us an update?
Yes, we we've selected a outreach coordinator for South County Senior Center. This is a granted position, so she'll work reaching out to our seniors, making sure that all that, you know, all those services are available and reaching out to the people who have not heard about us yet or need help getting there or need some services. So we the Select Board of the Town of Deerfield, by virtue of the authority vested in us by the laws of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, do hereby appoint Annette Fourier McNamara, South County Senior Center Outreach Coordinator, for a term beginning December 14th, 2016, and ending on June 30th, 2017. Given at Deerfield, Massachusetts, this 14th day of December 2016. So I'll make a motion to appoint.
And I'll second the motion.
Oh, okay. I was going to say I can jump in, but Kip, you beat me to it.
Can I see that, Trevor, just for a second?
Sure.
Okay. Is there any further discussion?
None.
She becomes a town employee, even though it's for the...
Right. I was just wondering why this formality that we don't do with other people. That
I'm not
have.
Sure where that came from.
Part of it is because she becomes our employee and that there's an oversight board similar to the SCEMS.
But we didn't do this for the girl we hired for the South County EMS.
I don't know.
We're getting fancier now.
Yeah, maybe. But we kind of did the same thing. I mean, we voted to do it.
It's a good format.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's just a different form. Or a form versus please
but,
appoint this person.
Yet, Mike, who made this?
I don't know.
Did this come from the...
it may have either Pat may have done it or I know she had been talking with Barbara.
Barbara.
Or Marlene might have.
So do we sign this, I guess?
Yes.
Okay.
What that... all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
I would think maybe Barbara...
Yeah, Barbara might, so that she has the authority to do the paperwork on this person.
Okay.
I don't know. I mean, we did sign though for the South County EMS something.
Not that nice.
Not that nice.
We should talk.
This is like official.
This is official.
Well, maybe we have an official form from now on instead of just sign here. I don't know. There is one more thing that, two more things that we have to vote. And actually, both of them are re-votes. I went to FERCOG last week. Pat Smith, knowing that we were challenged with staff, she sat down with me and we redid the cover page for our debris management. We did the cover page and the index that we're adopting. So I will make it. I just
before.
Need you to vote. You said you're making the motion to approve the certificate of adoption, and you just read this.
Okay.
And then what happens is then this, we just put this by the SEMP plan, our emergency, comprehensive emergency management plan. And if we have a loss, we pull this out. We physically have to show this to the FEMA guy. And because we are voting that goes in the front of the page on today's date, then we have met all the checkoff lists, and then we can get reimbursed in an event. Cool. We have done everything.
We have to have a plan before they... will approve.
Yes, and this plan...
And where do we take the debris?
We are voting the
it's
regional...
Got to say somewhere in here.
No.
That's what I was wondering.
No, the regional plan has been approved in July by FEMA. The regional plan it allows for Montague, and there's a site in Montague that's approved by DEP and FEMA, and there's one on Route 2 somewhere. We wouldn't be using the Route 2 one. And
but if there was a bad disaster here, you mean we as a town couldn't just take all our trash and put it on our landfill and sort it out from there?
If you want reimbursement, no.
You would bring it. You would bring it there.
Kip, you can read this. I went to a three-day class on how to do debris management, and you have to have a certain height. You got to have a checker up at a certain height so we can look into the dump truck. The dump trucks have to be a certain size. You have to, identified by size. They have to go through and around this whole thing so they can get checked off.
Thank God all that stuff's going to change quick here.
Really, this is it. If you want a dime,
no, I don't.
This is what you've got to do.
And okay, so I make a motion to
just
to
think
adopt.
Of how many times, Kip, you are only voted in May, and you now have voted this debris management plan three times. We are finally getting it correct.
I don't remember the first two.
We did it back in September.
We did.
Yeah.
I know, and we did it back in...
And why was it wrong?
Because we did not have the...
The cover page.
Huh. And I thought we did it correctly in September because we did it wrong in August, the beginning of August.
I'd be willing to bet when it comes to paying money, we're going to have done something wrong once again.
No, we are not.
Government will find, bigger government than us will find a reason not to pay.
Because I have gamed the system now. I know you put so much paperwork. You show them that paperwork and no one will argue with you. That's exactly what we're doing here.
The answer is there.
Okay,
right there.
I'm going to make a motion.
All right.
Motion to accept the certificate of adoption. Town of Deerfield, Massachusetts Select Board, a resolution adopting the Town of Deerfield, Franklin County Disaster Debris Management Plan. Whereas the Town of Deerfield has reviewed the Franklin County Disaster Debris Management Plan developed by the Franklin Regional Council of Governments, and whereas the Franklin County Disaster Debris Management Plan contains information about pre-certified disaster debris management sites and guidelines and procedures to assist in the recovery from potential impacts from multiple hazards in the town of Deerfield, and will enable the town to benefit from the increased cost share adjustments available under the FEMA Public Assistance Alternative Procedures PAAP pilot program for debris removal, and whereas a duly noticed public meeting was held by the Select Board on December 14, 2016, and whereas the Town of Deerfield authorizes responsible departments and/or agencies to execute their responsibilities demonstrated in the plan, and now, therefore, be it resolved that the Select Board adopts the Franklin County Disaster Debris Management Plan, adopted and signed this 14th day of December 2016.
I already wrote that you seconded.
I second that motion.
Okay,
that was a mouthful, Trevor.
Yes.
But I have a question. When that tornado went through Springfield and up through Brimfield and Munson, yep. Was there a name for that tornado?
That was a declared event. That was a declared event, though.
Regardless of name, but what happens if we have a similar situation that wipes out all these sites to bring the debris to?
Well,
then,
we'll be clear,
guess
maybe.
What? We'll have something
they did,
else.
Like after that with Snowtober, yeah. When all that, I remember going through Long Meadow, yeah. You couldn't even see the houses because all the trees on both sides, they had a specific spot set up where all that debris went, and then it was chipped, and then all the chips went somewhere else, and there was a couple other.
You see, when I go to a lot of these functions, I see my picture with a red circle and a slash through it. I ask these kinds of questions.
It's good.
No,
it's good to know. You got to be educated.
I don't know if we couldn't get to Montague because, like, if we had a flooding damage,
right.
and say the bridge was wiped out, you couldn't get over there.
Yeah.
You know, what would happen is you would say you have a secondary site, and you would just pick a site.
Okay.
But, there is procedures, but I. Don't know. So
that's all, right.
all those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so what we're going to do is make three copies of this. We'll have it posted all over the place, and it'll be in the front of the book, which will be on the file next to the SEMP plan.
Okay.
So when the guy,
plan?
Comprehensive Emergency Management Plan, it has all the procedures you're supposed to do when you have an emergency.
I'll try to figure out where that is in case the bridge gets washed out and you can't make it to town hall. I should know.
No, I've already been down here before the event because I would have declared, because you start collecting. That's why I always declare events ahead of time if it's weather-based and you have enough information, because, you know, all the preparation by the police chief and the highway department, you can start collecting that just in case you get reimbursed.
I'm surprised all school kids don't call you and ask you to, you know, declare an event.
I know. But it's only because I've had to fight all this paperwork, and I don't want us to be disadvantaged and not be able to collect.
We're going to thank you.
We have been able to collect on all our events since 2005, and it's because there was such a sharp learning curve in 2005 flooding, and no one came.
Yeah.
And I will never be in that position again. And
I mean, no one came to help.
No, that's when I called the governor's office, Mitt Romney's.
They were gone.
Twerp, and he was down in South Carolina making jokes about Massachusetts, and the guy says, "You don't have. How could you possibly have $4 million worth of damage?" And
there's nothing out there.
There's nothing out there. That's literally his words. And he said the same thing he told to Chris Forgy when she had people in shelters and that trailer park area was washed away. And we actually had $4.6 million worth of damage. That's when the upper road got washed out.
Yep.
It was horrendous. Yeah.
There's nothing out there.
It was only going through Stan Rosenberg and Steve Kulik that we even, and we, he didn't declare event until the following week. It was terrible.
Hmm.
And so anyway, that's when I got involved with the conservation districts, and we do NRCS and Emergency Watershed Protection Program now, because that's money whether you have a declared event or not. And we have mostly threatened structures versus wiped out structures and infrastructure, and that is a FEMA thing, thank God. We don't, you know, we deal with NRCS instead of FEMA, because FEMA is terrible. But anyway, okay. So one more thing that we need to vote on is we've done this already, and we did appoint, but we have to do this in the proper manner to be legal by January 1st. So I will make a motion to appoint Barbara Hancock, the town clerk. We are voting the town clerk position as our public records access officer. We are publicly declaring her as our public records access officer tonight. We will post it on the website. We will post it in the lobby. We will post it outside our town clerk office. We will also make a motion to appoint the police clerk for police-related activities, which is Debbie, which we have already done in the past as well. But we are announcing tonight that any police-related events will be the public access records officer will be the police clerk. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. I'm going to put down Trevor a second. Just
quick. Yes, he's quick. I was reading.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. We will now post this and be properly.
Hopefully get none.
Yeah. I mean, hopefully this will be done. I mean, we've done this a couple times, too.
Mm-hmm. Do we want to make a motion to approve our minutes from last week?
We don't actually have minutes.
Really?
Yes. Why, did you see minutes? No, there's no minutes, as far as I know.
I read the old ones.
What minutes did you read? The minutes of...
I thought they were on the website. Not on the website, I thought she emailed them.
It would be December 5th and 6th.
Okay.
I think the 6th was our executive session, which is in public anyway.
Right.
And,
met last Tuesday. Yeah, that's right. It was sick. Okay.
Was it? Yeah. Okay. So we met last. Pat, I don't think Pat had them. At least I didn't see any. Did you see any?
I didn't. Okay. I don't recall.
Well, so we'll do it next week. Okay. This is, Pat just has to fill this out. I don't want to handprint this. She can write it in.
for the public right access. I mean, she should print that in so it's not messy. Okay, just a couple things. Did you have any old business, either one of you? Oh,
well, I happened to notice this thing about the school building authority in our packet.
Okay, one second. Sure. Just so Bruce St. Peters won't get mad at me, because I'm supposed to announce that there are openings on the Conservation Commission, Cultural Council, Open Space, Personnel, Tri-Town Beach, ZBA Alternate, a Cable, Solid Waste District, and Memorial Forest. So we're, it's still not, I don't believe it's on the website, but we are doing it, Bruce, I promise. Okay, so I'm off the hook. Now it's your turn. Because I actually wanted you to discuss the roof so that people knew. Did you ever get the number that was the original estimate?
I'm not sure. And the reason I say that is I went through some of this paperwork, and I did come up with a figure of $2,216,709. But I don't know if that was what estimate that was, because there were so many of them. Mm-hmm. I reached out to Alicia from Pink, and she has not gotten back to me. But that's the number that
What was it, 2 million?
$2,216,709.
I don't know if that was... for some reason, that seems lower.
Yeah, I think it's like but 3 million.
I thought it was up towards 3 million myself.
I'm not sure. But see, I don't know if they added in all their contingencies and stuff. But regardless, right. The bottom line is it cost us 1,569,000.
Wait, 1,569,806.45.
Oh, and
man, that's wonderful, Kip.
All but $18,000 should be reimbursable, not reimbursable, available, qualified for reimbursement, a 52% reimbursement. I guess that's the way you say it.
Yep.
So, yeah.
So this actually ends up being less than $800,000 for us.
Yeah.
Kip, that is really, really amazing.
It worked out well. And this, I've been preaching about this. This is half of the paperwork. But in these documents, we do have three hard copies of all of the warranties for all of the roofs, whether they're the applied rubber roofs or the shingles. And we have the warranties from the HVAC contractors, electrical contractors, the lightning contractors, the roofing contractors, and like that. We also have plans, and it came in digital format.
Thank
besides
you.
Email, we have zip drives as well.
And those are over, Priscilla will file them in the cabinet at the address. So
I almost think we should load them.
That's fine too. I mean, if people want to do that, it's just that
just to load them in a system so we can find them someday when a tornado hits.
I don't know how much
memory.
I don't know how much memory it takes up on a computer system.
I could ask John and see what he thinks.
Yeah, I mean, certainly it doesn't matter to share.
Yeah,
I mean, more places better.
Right.
Just so you folks know that I did sign off on the closeout documents, and I read it, and all that said, what I signed was that I did receive hard copies of all of that stuff. Okay. The second thing.
So this takes care of that email that we had.
I don't know. I didn't read this yet. That's what I was going to talk
to
you about.
Sorry.
But
I'm sorry.
The second thing that I did sign off on was all of the change orders, and what that was is it was there was a spot from the town to sign off saying that all of the change orders that were made, that we did get proper credit for them. And I went down through, I don't know, I think there was about 70 of them, and we did get proper credit for all of them.
Great.
To the best of my knowledge. And I looked through all of my records, and I asked Damien to provide them with me, and everything that I had matched his, so I had no problem with that. I don't really know what this is, because I haven't had a chance to read it, but it's something that they're looking for us to sign off on something here.
Well,
What
I did is I emailed back this Jess person, and I told them that we would discuss it at our selectmen's meeting and that we had authorized you to sign off on anything that was necessary. So I didn't want her to think that we weren't answering her because she had mailed this, I mean, it came in yesterday, but.
Yeah, I would, if you don't mind, I would like
fine.
To take some time and read this and make sure I understand what it is that I'm signing.
No, that's fine. And, I told her that we would get back to her after our meeting, so.
All right.
No one's going to say, well, you know, you didn't get back to me Thursday. You can do it for next week. It's fine.
If I find that there's, you know, there's no question about it, then I'll just sign it and get it back to them. But if I have any questions, I'm just going to wait, and we can speak.
Because it doesn't say me. It just says who's authorized. Yeah,
it doesn't say. So I can wait until our next meeting, and then we can talk about it.
Well, actually, I was really... Just go ahead.
It's got all the figures and stuff in it.
Oh, no, I'm saying as long as I'm comfortable with it.
Oh,
if I'm uncomfortable with it. Or
oh, then
if there's things that I don't think is right.
I don't want to hold up the thing.
No, I don't want to hold it up either. But I just, all I'm saying is that if I'm comfortable with it, I'll do it. If I'm uncomfortable or I don't understand, I'll seek information and bring it back
and
to the board.
And if I get another email, I'll just tell her that we're still reviewing it.
Yeah, okay.
But we shouldn't, because the way I wrote it back is that... Okay. That we had authorized you to sign it. We were going to discuss it at the meeting, and you know, and thank her very much for following up or whatever.
All right,
whatever.
Yep. Yeah, it's got all the figures in that.
I didn't have any. The problem was, I didn't want to sign off on it because we designated you as the person that knows what's going on.
Yeah,
Well, that's why I want to read it because
I know.
As I do read through some of these things. Sometimes they are a bit confusing because they all seem to.
Well,
there's 5 pages just to say hello sometimes.
This chart does a pretty good job of saying what's, you know,
right.
what's excluded from it. You know, like $84,000 is scoped items is not.
Well, this is exactly where I got that $2 million thing. It says a total projected budget.
Right.
But I, you know, this was after. Some manipulation, I say manipulation, there were changes that were made along the way. So
correct.
I don't.
But also, you know what? I don't think this includes the engineering, the initial engineering.
There's a feasibility. It says in the
front.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think
feasibility?
It does.
So that's where we were getting close to, like, the $3 million.
I just found an article here that said 2.9 million.
2.9.
That's what I thought.
See, I think that's more accurate.
Yeah.
So we went from a $2.9 million projected... down to an actual one of $1,569,806.
Yeah.
I mean, that's half of what the projected cost was. That's really amazing.
It is, but do you remember, I watched this on television the night that they were in here, and... They were looking to secure that the town had the money. And you remember saying how we could get bonded for all this money. They were looking in excess of $3 million.
Right.
And we're like, no.
Yeah.
We're not going to borrow extra money.
It was terrible.
It was terrible. It was a terrible experience. It was an eye-opening experience. I don't want to say it was terrible. It was just
it was, you know. It's troubling to think that, you know, we're the consumers.
One little hokey-pokey little town.
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
Yep.
Everywhere across the country this is happening. It's terrible.
Yeah.
I mean, really, seriously, this is just a replacement of a roof. This isn't even doing anything else.
I know. It's a lot.
Oh. But anyway. The only other thing... Well, we need to talk about SCEM stuff because I'm not going to be able to make the meeting next Tuesday. But I did want to announce this is a grant for $179,620 from the Forest Rivers group of the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. This goes towards culvert replacement on the Deerfield River.
Okay.
And
great.
Maybe... One of the little bit of it will get into Deerfield. I don't know, but it'll be somewhere up and down the Deerfield River. This is just one little group more money that we're getting for our resilient communities group that we keep looking for. But it's hard to say if it will actually come into Deerfield. But Kevin's on top of stuff, so hopefully we will see the money. Some money. The culvert, the Conservation District. gave the town of Deerfield $20,000 towards that culvert by Melnick's. And of course, the other one we want to do is
just down the road.
Just down the road. So that's one kind of what we're hoping for. So we'll see. I unfortunately, this when they moved this, when I picked this date of December 20th, it was a random Tuesday before Christmas. I didn't think there would be any conflicts. So this is the annual meeting of the Franklin Conservation District, which I chair, and it's published by the state, and it's, you know, it's our annual meeting, and where we have a elect our supervisors. So unfortunately, I cannot make the SCEMS meeting when they moved it to the 20th. Okay. So
you're going to miss all the fun.
I did want to bring up a couple things as the, and which I have here, I don't know, I got to find it, is the Capital Improvement Planning Committee approved, yes, but I had the original signed one.
Oh.
By John Parse. Yep. Anyway, it's here somewhere.
Okay.
The Capital Improvement Committee has approved the ambulance replacement amount. We are going to be considering on December 28th the rest of Zach's expenditures, you know, for the equipment and all that stuff. But the ambulance.
28th is
Wednesday at 5:30.
Oh, 5:30 before the select board. Okay.
So we'll go through the rest of them. We just didn't have time, and so this is done. So we want to make sure that comes. I had the latest payroll, and I'm not sure if the person that we appointed last week has kicked in or what the deal was. But the overtime is much reduced, which is wonderful, and. We seem to be doing okay. We have one more pay period to get to the 50% mark, and we're just on the payroll. We're just shy of 49%. I mean, of 50%. So that's really good. The call staff number is way under, but of course that wasn't really budgeted all that much. Overtime. Is you know we just have to watch that, but so we're doing better.
So
we're doing
looks like
okay.
It's in better
yes.
condition than it
yes.
was the last couple months.
We kept, you know, we've been harping about it, and I feel bad because I know
have
I know
other
they were
hours
short.
Gone up. I mean, how did they do that?
I mean, well, I think if you look,
that
at
one
the,
person's only been there for a week since we
right.
Voted,
but so. I think what's happening, you get your call, you have call hours coming in. You can see. The hours, and I think they have been pulling in other staff because we
they've
do
been
have
using some per
yeah
diems.
Yeah they
volunteer,
people
maybe.
Have people have volunteered time forward, so you know, because we were worried about that, and we've talked about it in the last couple meetings, you know, if people make more of an effort to the next couple months, and it seems like it's working. The only thing of the SCEMS that I was concerned about, and it might be under budget, just if you can check how are things going, is the vehicle maintenance. I know they had a terrible time with
the international.
Yeah, it was in the shop, and the original budget was $18,800.
And
we've already
70%
spent.
Of that.
Yeah, we've used over 70%, and it just a dash over 70. So, we're kind of, you know, do they see any issues or anything? Or at the end of the year,
right,
this is no different than other departments. We can change
right
money within up to 5%. So if you know, if we had to, we can move money around. But that's the only thing I can think of. And the, we've only budgeted 17%.
I mean, $17,000 for professional training, and I just, and we, so we've used up that, and I just want to make sure that we have everybody certified, because that could be, I didn't know if, you know, if anybody's got certification issues still. You know, you have to do, you know, mandatory education hours, and so just, I would just, you know, this is a halfway mark, this meeting, December meeting.
So we've got the vehicle maintenance, and what was the other one?
Vehicle maintenance was a little over 70%.
Yeah.
And, you know, your professional training and education, you have to do a certain number of hours,
sure,
and stuff for your certification. So we're almost 89%.
Okay.
So did we under budget? Because you'll be talking about the budget this time. So those are the only two items that seem kind of out of whack.
Yeah.
And that, you know, we've employee benefits. This could be related
insurance.
To, yes, how many people are have insurance. Yeah. So, so I don't think that's really out of whack too much, because
right,
that's a one-shot deal. So this actually might, if this has been paid for, then I did not check with Barbara to see if that was a yearly amount,
mm-hmm,
or if it's just going to end up projection of like 10% short.
Right.
So
right,
we'll have to look at that. But in general, it looks really good. We are, you know, things have improved dramatically since the, you know, August, September time. So that's good.
Can I see that when you're done?
Yeah.
You sure?
No, it's good.
Done. All right.
Yep.
So I just wanted to bring up that. And also, we have to, I wrote a memo to the personnel committee, and I apologize for them, for us, for me making a motion and voting for our new hire last week. But, you know, we just really couldn't afford another
month.
And we might have lost that person if,
mm-hmm,
we weren't able to hire her. So anyway, I wrote an apology to the personnel committee, but we need to set up some kind of protocol so department heads will come to the personnel hearing,
mm-hmm,
for out of, I know we're going to work on the compensation,
mm-hmm,
scale, but if you are asking for a different grade or a different step in the grade than what is normal or what was posted or whatever, then you need to come. We have to set up some kind of paperwork justification. And
but it one
like
of the
things
that seems, you know, and it's the problem that I have with the whole thing is the time. It takes so much time. But I realize that we have volunteers on these boards.
Mm-hmm.
But if the personnel board should meet on a Monday night, and Wednesday of the same week, you know, somebody wants to hire, realistically, they're not going to know for a month.
I know.
And that just doesn't seem right.
That's why it's my responsibility. I'm taking it on so that the personnel committee can be mad at me.
Because we can find a process that we could.
But I just didn't feel that we could wait another month on that.
No, I agree on this one. And there'll be, it seems like there'll be others. Like Kip's thing, you can't have somebody wait a month to find out. But maybe there's a process, when we get together and discuss this,
but
how
maybe
we can do this.
How about something like this that, you know, I know that they can't talk without being in a meeting, but if there's a request, that the request be emailed to each of these members so they can think about it, and then they could call a five-minute meeting, you know, just say, post it, and say they're going to just come down here, and they could, amongst themselves, can pick a time that's good, doesn't matter, morning, noon, or evening, you know, as long as it's posted that way, then come down and say, look, what do you think about this? And they're in and out of here in 5 minutes. It's not a real inconvenience.
Not a long thing, like kind of like signing warrants or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Or maybe they can, once we have a town administrator,
get
info through them.
Through them, too. Yep.
That's well, true. I mean, obviously, most of this problems is because we don't have a town administrator.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know the packet was presented. I know Zach put the packet to Pat. Pat put the packet to the
The board.
The personnel board, and, you know, stuff just happens. And but we need to think of a procedure. And Wendy, I had CC'd her on the email when mm-hmm. I sent an email to the personnel board because I wanted her to know that I did something out of kilter. And so anyway, she was thinking that, you know, we could do a form kind of like the capital expenditure form where you have your justification.
Right.
And you just explain it. But you also, I mean, I think it is important that the department head goes because they could answer questions.
Right.
And then it's done and not dragged out another whole month. I think the dragging out is gets people down.
No one from the ambulance, I think it was a couple of months, you know, and I can understand the frustrations. Why, you know, they can't assume things, and if the people, the department heads, you know, can't take the time to go to these things, you know, what do they expect? You know,
well, I know they have the packet on for Zach's pay, but we don't really know a lot on that evaluation. So maybe at the meeting you can ask Bob Ahern or someone that would volunteer to go to the meeting of the personnel committee in January so that Zach's compensation can be addressed, because I mean it's in the budget, it just hasn't been voted and recommended by the personnel committee, so we need to sort that out, and so that we could discuss what we need for the personnel committee to have a favorable outcome. I mean, we have to have an evaluation or something. There has to be some basis for this.
Well, there was an evaluation. And,
right,
you know,
I know.
But nobody came to explain it other than, them just reading it.
I mean, somebody should be willing to do that. And maybe Bobby Wood Tom Feinkevich or somebody.
I guess, but then again, it is important. But, you know, this thing here, this was pretty elaborate. I mean, I don't know. I guess.
Well, I think they had some questions.
Yeah.
And
as we're talking about that, I think that it's really pretty important that we sit down much sooner than later with the personnel board and develop this pay rate table and scrap all the other ones.
I agree.
I mean, in the past, you know, Doug brought us something from some survey and, you know, they did all these comparisons, you know. We know what people are getting paid now. And, you know, I'm not talking about raising pay. I'm just talking about having this table set up. So we know what everybody has. We can start with grades 1 through 5, steps 1 through 10, and just assign a number to all of these things, and then it be done. And then there's no more, well, this and that. And these are what they get paid. You know, you're at this grade, this step, and, you know, we know. And then going forward, if somebody wants a grade raise or a step raise or a grade and step raise, or, you know, then we've got it right in front of us. One of the big confusion is because there's so many different ones. Which one do we go by? You know, I asked Barbara for something, and she supplied me with something, and then I went to the personnel board, and they had something different. You know, so I asked Pat, and she pulled something out, and yet that was different too. The only consensus I found is what people were actually getting paid. That's when I saw the consensus of, you know, adding the grades and steps and stuff. But the charts were all over the place. You know, so.
Well, I think some of them, I mean, we can do some research. I just don't want to spend any more money.
Oh, no. There's
and,
no.
And so I think we can do a lot of the research ourselves on the Internet.
Right.
And one that I think needs to be reviewed right off, clearly, is the town administrator one.
Well, there's
and
two.
And we know the paramedic one is out of
sync. We're talking about two different things here, Carol. I'm not talking about what we pay the people, just creating our chart. This has nothing to do with the people.
Because you're talking about the range?
In other words, we need to start, if the way that I understand
the
town is we have
about.
A great.
We have to. We know the range is not adequate.
But we can go right up to $110,000 with our scale. It doesn't mean that we're going to pay people that, but now we have a scale to go from now and well into the future.
Well, that's what I'm talking
about.
All
we
need. We need to know, but not every line. I mean, you just can't add
20% to each line.
Oh, no, 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 no.
That's why you have. That's why you have grades. You.
Right.
But we have tons of research. We have that. I can't think of the gentleman's name.
Don Jacobs.
Don Jacobs. We have his report. We have the one from the other woman. And then we
can get one from the COG.
And so we can look at these things, and whether they go in 30-cent increments or 80-cent increments, it doesn't matter. But let's make one that goes well above what we're currently paying people, only so in the future we don't have to fumble through this again.
Oh, yes,
you know?
Yes.
We can,
I was looking at, I wanted us to look at the ones that, like the town accountant.
Well, it doesn't
the
matter.
The town administrator, those we know are way out of whack, and those are not going to get fixed by 60-cent increments.
No, but all I'm saying is I'm not trying to assign a dollar value to any person or any position.
Oh, right.
Just have a chart. This is what the minimum is $12 and the maximum is $80, you know, or whatever. You can just go right up through. And that
you have to know what jobs are assigned to that grade, so you have an idea of, because some of the grades are not going to change because they haven't changed.
But even that's getting more elaborate than what I'm speaking of. I'm just saying, let's just make the chart, you know, let's put numbers to this chart. So we know if you're a grade 2, step 5, this is what the dollar amount is regardless, you know, and, you know, then we can go, once we got a chart established, then we can go back and say, okay, how much do the average EMTs make? Is it 20, 30? Okay, so now they fit into our chart like this. What does a town accountant get? Now it fits into our chart. As long as we have this chart that shows us what each step in grade is, then we can work within those parameters. But since we don't have a constant chart, you say, well, this person is a step 1, grade 3, or vice versa. You know, well, this one was paid that. Well, that's when we changed it, you know, and it's like, oh, yeah, yeah. So you never really know how to compare apples to apples because the charts are all over the place.
Well, you have the consolidation of the charts, but, like, some of the jobs are assigned to the grades have been argued, too. So.
Yeah, well, that's fine.
And we can address that, I guess, later.
As long as we can decide, do we want to have, you know, 5 grades, 6 grades, or 10 grades. And then once we decide how many grades we have, then we can how many, you know, scales up from that do you want to go? And then, you know, then you can say, well, this job is this grade 4, this one's a grade 6. And, you
know. I know. I mean, that's some of that can be solved by just changing grades, too.
Yep.
But you don't want to mess with the grades too much because the grades involve supervision. Mm-hmm. And
well, right, but
and that was part of the, and it didn't always work. It didn't always work, because someone like Karen, in the assessor's office, doesn't supervise anybody.
Right.
But she has all these certificates that essentially is her assessor's person. So mm-hmm. she was it was hard to find a grade that fit her. So what you have to do is. When you're doing that chart, it's not as simple because you have to read the definition of the grade.
But why complicate it like that? If you use the pay chart as just a guideline as to you're assigning a grade and a step. Now you can go back, and regardless of what your chart says, you can say, okay, the fire chief gets $80,000 a year. You break it up. Okay, that fits within this grade and this step. So that's now you've got.
Oh,
the,
I see what you're doing.
Now you go
yeah.
back to, you know.
You just want to bump it up, but
all I want is something that's concise.
We can do that really fast.
So,
I mean, that can be relatively quickly done.
Because we just went through this with.
But
the EMTs, some EMTs are at one grade and another step. Now, why is this EMT not starting at a higher step? You know, that's if you have the same scale for everybody that you can go to and get rid of all the other ones, then it would make that portion of our life a lot easier. And then we can assign a value to each job, you know, and that will take a little more research. But
we can do the first run at that. It's just. Some of this, the way Don, you don't want to throw it out because
seemed like it was pretty good. In most cases, it was pretty good. And Don Jacobs' guidelines were made sense. But there was some issues, like with Karen, that you had to fiddle with. So as long as we had the ability to fiddle still, then we could be okay. So, you know, do you understand what?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Then I think we could do this at the beginning of January.
I guess what I'm saying is, like, if you have grades 1 through 6 and you have steps 1 through 10, and say somebody is, I've got to write this down because I'll confuse myself.
No, that's okay.
Okay. Say you're a grade 2, and through the course of years you get raises, you know, you deserve them. Now all of a sudden you get to a grade 10, okay?
You're done.
No. The next thing is you go down to, now you're a grade 3 and a step 1. You see what I mean? Because that one would be higher. So it's kind of like a chart where the pay rates keep going up.
That negates what Don Jacobs was saying, is that what he was saying is that when you get to step 10, like what's happening, because nothing's been done since 2009 as a formal review. We've had stuff, but we didn't adopt anything. So what he was saying, then you got 1 through 10.
Yeah.
And then what you do is you still take that grade 2 and you just bump it up by 80 cents or whatever, 60 cents an hour. So now you've essentially reset your through 10 over here.
But then
have not moved them to grade 3 because grade 3 envisions another skill set or a supervision. Like this would be a laborer person. This would be a foreman person. And so what you're doing is you have to reset. You reset the range. This is a range. And you just are resetting the range every... We were supposed to do this every 7 years.
But why assign a title to the grade? You can know that saying that, okay, a person of supervision authority should be paid more, so we're going to put them into the higher grades, but why assign it, you know, that it has to be that? That way
what we did is we reviewed all the job descriptions, mm-hmm. and the job descriptions then went to Don, and he reviewed them, and he put them in the different grades, and then we reviewed what he did. We argued back and forth, like when someone like Karen was too low because of her skill set, certifications. So she ended up getting bumped up a grade, even though there was no supervision of personnel.
Right,
she does
but
not
the
have
bottom money. Line is we're paying her more money. So you're paying her more money.
So that's why she had she went up
a higher grade. Why don't I make a chart and show you what, or maybe that would help you understand what I'm saying, because you can put somebody in a supervisory position and just pay them more, but you can look at it and say, okay, if we're going to pay them $30 an hour, that comes out to be, it's a grade 4, step 5, you know. But the way I'm thinking is, you know, you have this, you start at 1 and it goes 1 through 10, then you come over to 2, then you got 1 through 10, then you go to 3, 1 through, so in other words, 3-1 would be a little bit more than 10-2. And then when you got to 3-10, you go to 4-1, because 4-1 would be more than that. So you don't necessarily assign a grade for the job. It's the dollar value that you're using.
Right, but what Don was saying is that you couldn't keep bumping this person up just for sheer longevity, because that job wasn't worth... You know,
well, then you don't move them. That's my whole point. If they're not worthy of the raise, then they stay where they are. But if they are worthy, then you just move them up to the next.
But that's why we have to look at each grade and see what the range is, because some ranges, like clerical range, is not going to change, but a town administrator range has got to be bumped up because we basically have not been able to hire
anyone.
Right,
but so getting
when
back
get to
that.
That grade 6,
it could be a grade 6-1 or it could be a grade 6-8, you know. There's a big difference
but
between those.
But you reset things. What you're doing, what he was set up, is that you reset this range. You went like this instead of what you're talking about is moving vertical. what you always are doing is horizontal, but you're just resetting the range. Mm-hmm. And you just bump it based on what the marketability of, say a clerical person or a laborer, they have a marginal improvement because, you know, they would just have like a cost of living or an inflationary factor. Whereas your town accountants, they're scarce, and we you know, everyone's just stealing from everybody else. And so that goes up by increments of
I understand that. And this thousands. That still could work this way. You would just, you're not assigning any particular grade to the position. It's the dollar amount that you're using within. You're just using this as a chart as to what, you know, what you're paying and or what you could advertise that you paid for or what that position
pays. Well, the idea is so that you've removed any personal input. It's just the range, and this is what we're going to pay. So it's not, oh, you made the decision to bump this person from grade 2 to grade 3. You know, we did a vote. You know,
we did that anyways, just with this other person, you know? So
no, we did the step. Okay. We knew we went in the range. What we did is we did paramedic.
Okay.
Instead of step 1, instead of step 3, we did step 6.
Okay.
And so but ultimately you have to reset the range. What we need to do is we need to track down Don Jacobs' original thing
report
so you can look at how he set it up.
I think I have that.
I'm not married to it, believe me, because there were some issues. But
Let me work on that a little bit.
But I think the concept of the range and just resetting the range is ultimately better because then you stay more competitive without overpaying. Because if you just bump everybody up automatically.
You know why it doesn't make sense to me, Carolyn, is because when you advertise a job, you don't say Deerfield's going to pay grade 6, step 4. Nobody's going to know what the hell you're talking about.
No, you pay a range.
Right.
Like,
well, that's what I'm saying. So you're
60, like for the town administrator.
You're going to pay between $60,000 and $70,000.
Yes.
But when that's what I'm saying. You do that. That's a dollar amount you advertise. But when we're going to have a chart, so we're going to know where that fits in. It's for us to use.
I think all we're arguing about is we're actually on the same page. No, we really are. It's just the grade, I think, was confusing.
Okay.
And so that I think if you read the report, you would understand where he was saying about the resetting of the range and, like, how we haven't reset our town administrator range.
Well, in either way, I think we should get together with the personnel board as soon as we can.
Do they meet the first Monday of the month?
The personnel board, usually, yes.
Is it first Monday?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so maybe we can set up a joint meeting.
They'd be the 9th.
The 9th?
Be the 11th.
Why do I have that number down? I mean, let's see. I have to go check my calendar, but maybe we can meet on the 9th. Would that be okay with you?
I have more than likely have a planning board meeting. They meet
that's
at 7 o'clock.
Yeah, but the personnel meets at 5.
They meet early. Yeah,
no,
I could come.
Would that be okay?
Monday the 9th?
Yeah. Do you have available at 5 o'clock? I have to check my calendar at home. I didn't bring it.
I'm
going to
put it down now.
Okay. 5 o'clock?
Well, yeah. So I'll see if Pat can set up a joint meeting. Because we need to re-advertise for or do
yeah,
you know, we have to
we
sort out the town administrator
mm-hmm.
thing. So
yep.
We need to at least do that first, okay?
Yep.
And get that sorted out. Oh, I know why January 9th. That's our special town meeting that was canceled.
Right.
Oh jeez. That's why I've kept thinking. No, I got something going on that night. All right. Okay. We got rid of that meeting. Thank you, Bruce St. Peters. It looks like we're still going out that night, but it will be a lot earlier. Okay. Is there anything else that we had? There's no meeting next Wednesday, the 21st.
Really?
Yes. I've got to do Christmas stuff sometime. All my kids and their spouses are coming home this weekend. I mean, for Christmas, so I got
to check on this EMS director compensation. Will we be deciding that or discussing that on the 9th?
Yes.
We could.
I would like to move forward with that. Yeah, and we need to ask, you know, at the meeting, do you think you can get, ask Bob or Hearn or Tom Feinkevich, someone that had worked with...
To come and work with us?
Yeah, that had worked with Zach.
I think Bob or Hearn, if he would, if he could take some time to come that day.
Because I think, even though we haven't said it, I'm hoping that one of the things...
And this is pretty detailed, this here, that I've read it.
Yeah. But what we need to do, I think it's...
Important to have them there.
Yeah, we need to have a department head, and so the oversight board would be appropriate.
Correct.
And having someone that worked with Zach for that
first year. For that time.
Yep.
Not us, but...
So they can answer the questions about, you know, what was promised and
what
was the, the milestones where they were met and stuff. I mean, that is complete, but...
It is, but yeah, it would be good to have some backup.
Someone should advocate for Jack.
I agree, and I hope Bob will do it.
Yes.
I think he probably would, but I'll talk to him about it.
All right, and then, so we have department head, and then we got to make sure we have a packet each time. And maybe we can come up with a form so that they're consistent.
Yes.
I think that could be...
I like the CIPC.
Yeah, just a one-page.
Yeah.
Why? Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a good idea.
So we'll work on that. Did you guys have any other questions on the SCEM stuff? I just was really concerned about overspending the salary line, and it seemed
like it's coming in a lot.
It's yes, and so I just want to make sure that we're, you know, talking to the oversight board that, you know, we still have to be mindful because we're right on target, pretty much on target.
Right, and I think this extra person will help now.
Yeah, I do too, and you know, like I said, I wrote. I am a sorry note.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully that will work out. Nobody will be too mad at me. But I was glad that we got that done. So, okay.
And
well, listen.
All this stuff for the marijuana stuff that's coming into effect, what, tomorrow?
Yeah, but nobody's...
Really need to
no, we don't have
it?
To do anything yet.
Okay.
I'm sure, you know, when we go to Boston, there's going to be...
Some info on it.
Multiple classes on it, but we have only the overlay district. There's been no answer on whether that means that every commercial district that we have is now a marijuana district.
And retail, I mean, you really can't retail it until next year anyways. Personal, people can personally grow up to 12 plants in their house. They can have a certain amount with them, but they can't retail sell it for a year.
Right.
Because those places still need to come up and grow a crop.
I mean,
of it
obviously,
you
can't drive when you're high. I mean, we've got
to.
There's got to be a lot of stuff sorted out.
Yep.
Okay. So, anyway, happy holidays. Hope everyone has
Merry
healthy,
Christmas.
Happy.
Yes, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Well, although we'll be back.
Yeah, we'll be back on the 28th to wish Happy New Year.